It looks solid enough, doesn't it? In the late Middle Ages, the civilization of Northern Europe seemed designed to last forever. Rich merchants, self-satisfied guilds, a conveniently loose political organization, no material reasons for change. And yet, in a few years, in a single generation, came the first of those explosions that were to create contemporary man, what we call the Reformation. What went wrong with that solid-looking world? I can't see the answer outside the fortress of Würzburg, but inside it, in this room, one gets a hint of trouble. It contains carvings by a sculptor named Tilman Riemenschneider, perhaps the best of the many skillful craftsmen in late 15th century Germany. And these carvings are not only moving as works of art, they show very clearly the character of North European man about the year 1500. They show, to begin with, his serious personal piety, a quality quite different from the bland, conventional piety that one finds in a great deal of Italian art. And then a serious approach to life itself. These men were not to be fobbed off by forms and ceremonies. They believed there was such a thing as truth, and they wanted to get at it. What they heard from papal legates, who did a lot of traveling in Germany at this time, didn't convince them that there was the same desire for truth in Rome. And they had a rough, raw-boned peasant tenacity of purpose. So far, so good. But these faces reveal a more dangerous characteristic, a vein of hysteria. The 15th century had been the century of revivalism, religious movements on the fringe of the Catholic Church. Even in Italy, Savonarola persuaded his hearers to make a bonfire of their so-called vanities, including pictures by Botticelli, which I suppose was a bad day for civilization. The Germans were much more easily excited.
Look at this Italian cardinal by Raphael. He's not only a man of high culture, but completely self-contained. And compare him with one of the greatest of German portraits, Dürer's Oswald Krell. Those staring eyes, that look of self-conscious introspection, that uneasiness, marvelously conveyed by Dürer through the uneasiness of the planes and the modeling, how German it is, and what a nuisance for the rest of the world. However, in the 1490s, these destructive national characteristics hadn't yet shown themselves. It was still an age of internationals. And in 1498, there arrived in Oxford a poor scholar who was destined to become the spokesman of Northern civilization and the greatest internationalist of his day, Erasmus. Erasmus was a Dutchman. He came from Rotterdam. But he never went back to live in Holland. He'd been in a monastery there, and he'd hated it. And he'd also hated the coarse, convivial life of the average Netherlander. He was always complaining that they drank too much. He himself had a delicate digestion and would drink only a special kind of burgundy. All his life he moved from place to place, partly to avoid the plague, because that king of terrors kept all free men on the move throughout the early 16th century, and partly due to a restlessness that overcame him if he stayed anywhere too long. However, in his earlier life, he seems to have liked England, and he had a successful stay in Magdalen College, and so this country makes a brief appearance in our survey of civilization. You know, considering the barbarous and disorderly state of England of the 15th century, Oxford and Cambridge are astonishing creations. And the Oxford that welcomed Erasmus still contained a few, not very many I suppose, pious and enlightened men. Of course, the atmosphere must have been somewhat provincial and unsophisticated compared to Florence, even Bologna. And yet, about the year 1500, this kind of naivete had its value. And Erasmus, who was anything but naive, recognized it. He'd seen enough of the religious life to know that the church must be reformed not only in its institutions, but in its teachings. It was once the great civilizer of Europe, and now it was aground, stranded on forms and vested interests. And he knew that there was more hope of reform from the teachings of a man like Colet, the Dean of St. Paul's, who simply wanted people to read the Bible as if it were true, than from the sharp wits of Florence. The intelligence and the tact by which Erasmus made himself so immediately welcome by the finest minds in England are alive to us in his letters.
And by great good fortune, we can supplement these letters by visible evidence, because he was the friend of the most incisive portrait painter of the time, Hans Holbein. Holbein's portraits show Erasmus when he had become famous and elderly, but they have so complete a grasp of his character that we can imagine him at every age. Like all humanists, I might almost say like all civilized men, Erasmus set a high value on friendship. And he was anxious that Holbein should go to England to paint pictures of his friends. And finally, in 1526, Holbein went and was introduced into the circle of Sir Thomas More. The brilliant youth with whom 20 years earlier Erasmus had fallen in love was now Lord Chancellor. He was also the author of the Utopia, where in rather a quaint style, he recommends almost everything that was believed in by enlightened reformers in the 1890s. Holbein painted a large picture of Sir Thomas More and his family. Erasmus was staying in the house at the time. Alas, the picture was burnt, but the original drawing remains with the name of the sitters written in. Erasmus used to say that More's family were like the Academy of Plato. Well, in Holbein's studies of the heads, they don't look oppressively intellectual, but alert, sensible people of any epoch. Thomas More himself, of course, was a noble idealist, too good for the world of action, where he sometimes lost his way. It shows how quickly civilizations can appear and disappear. That the author of the Utopia should have flourished, should have become, in spite of himself, first minister of the crown, halfway between the death of Richard III and the judicial murders of Henry VIII, of which he, of course, was to be the most distinguished victim. Holbein depicted other members of Erasmus's circle in England, and I'm bound to say that some of them, like the archbishops, Wareham and Fisher, look as if they had no illusions about the transitory nature of civilization at the court of Henry VIII. They look defeated, and they were defeated. In 1506, Erasmus went to Italy. He was in Bologna at the exact time of Julius II's famous quarrel with Michelangelo. He was in Rome when Raphael began work on the papal apartments. But none of this seems to have made any impression on him. His chief interest was in printing, in the publication of his works by the famous Venetian printer and pioneer of popular editions, Aulus Manutius. Whereas in talking about Italy, one's concerned with the enlargement of man's spirit through the visual image, in the North, one's chiefly concerned with the extension of his mind through the word. And this was made possible by the invention of printing. In the 19th century, people used to think of the invention of printing as the linchpin in the history of civilization. Well, 5th century Greece and 12th century Chartres and 15th century Florence got on very well without it. And who shall say that they were less civilized than we are? Still, on balance, I suppose that printing has done more good than harm. One certainly feels that way in the beautiful humanized workshop of the Plantin Press in Antwerp. And one can't but look with awe on this simple seeming invention. It looks so easy to work. Well, it is easy to work. Roll it in like that. Take this arm, pull as hard as you can, very hard. Roll it back, open it up. And you take out your printed sheet. How easy they are to operate. You'd have thought that anyone could have thought of it, like the wheel. Yet it was so effective that it remained practically unchanged for about 400 years. And perhaps one's doubts about the civilizing effect of printing have been aroused by a later development of the craft. Of course, a printing had been invented long before the time of Erasmus. Gutenberg's Bible was printed in 1456. But these early printed books were sumptuous and expensive, done in competition with manuscripts. Men only gradually realized that printed books should reach as many people as possible. And it took preachers and persuaders almost 30 years to recognize what a formidable new instrument had come into their hands, just as it took politicians 20 years to recognize the value of television. The first man to take advantage of the printing press was Erasmus. It made him and unmade him, because in a way he became the first journalist. He'd all the qualifications. A clear, elegant style, in Latin, of course, which meant that he could be read everywhere, but not by everyone. Opinions on every subject. Even the gift of putting things so that they could be interpreted in different ways. Early in his journalistic career, he produced a masterpiece, The Praise of Folly.
He wrote it staying with his friend Thomas More. He said it took him a week. I dare say it's true. He had an amazing fluency. And this time, his whole being was engaged. You know, to an intelligent man, human beings and human institutions sometimes seem intolerably stupid. And there are times when one's pent-up feelings of impatience and annoyance can't be contained any longer. Erasmus's Praise of Folly was an outburst of this kind. It washed away everything. Popes, kings, monks, of course, scholars, war, theology, the whole works. This is a page from it with a marginal drawing by Holbein showing Erasmus at his desk. And over the drawing, Erasmus has written that if he was really as handsome as this, he wouldn't lack for a wife. In the ordinary way, satire is a negative activity. But there are times in the history of civilization when it has a positive value. Times when the flypaper of complacency holds down the free spirit. This was the first time in history that a bright-minded intellectual exercise, something to make people stretch their minds and think for themselves and question everything, has been made available to thousands of readers all over Europe. It happened that during the same period in which Erasmus was spreading enlightenment through the world, another development of the art of printing was nourishing the imagination. The illustrated book engraved on a wooden block like this. Of course, the illiterate faithful had for centuries been instructed by wall paintings and stained glass. But the vast multiplication of images that was made possible by the printed woodcut put this form of communication on quite a different footing. At once more widespread and more intimate. And as usual, the invention coincided with the man. And the man was Albrecht Dürer. He was born and brought up in Nuremberg, the town of the Meistersingers. That's his house just behind me there. The great German myth of the worthy craftsman can still be felt in such of its streets and squares as are still left standing. But Dürer, whose father had come to Nuremberg from Hungary, was not at all the pious German craftsman figure he was once supposed to be. He was a strange, uneasy character, intensely self-conscious and inordinately vain. This is his self-portrait now in Madrid. And you might think that self-love couldn't go much further, but it could, because 2 years later he did another self-portrait in which he deliberately painted himself in the traditional pose of Christ. Well, this seems to us rather blasphemous, and Dürer's admirers don't make it much better by explaining that he thought creative power was a divine quality and that he wished to pay homage to his own genius by depicting himself as God. Well, it's true that this belief in the artist as inspired creator was part of the Renaissance spirit. Leonardo talks a lot about it in his treatise on painting, but one can't imagine him painting himself as Christ. However, Dürer had certain qualities in common with Leonardo. Although he didn't share Leonardo's positive distaste for women, he wasn't far short of it. And he would certainly never have married if the bourgeois conventions of Nuremberg hadn't compelled him to do so. And then Dürer shared Leonardo's curiosity. But it was a curiosity about appearances, not about causes. He was almost entirely without Leonardo's determination to find out how things worked. He collected rarities and monstrosities of a kind which 100 years later would have furnished the first museums. He would go anywhere to see them. Eventually he died as a result of an expedition to see a stranded whale in Zeeland. He never saw it, it had been washed away before he got there. However, he did see a walrus, whose shiny snout delighted him.
Dürer's curiosity about nature had less questionable results in the drawings he did of flowers and grasses and animals. No man has ever described natural objects more minutely. And yet, to my eye, something is missing, the inner life. This drawing of blades of grass, which is greatly admired, looks to me like the back of a case containing a stuffed animal.
But if Dürer didn't try to peer so deeply into the inner life of nature, nor feel, as Leonardo did, its appalling independence of mankind, he was deeply engaged by the mystery of the human psyche. His obsession with his own personality was part of a passionate interest in psychology in general. And this led him to produce one of the great prophetic documents of Western man, the engraving he entitled Melancholia I.
In the Middle Ages, melancholia had meant a simple combination of sloth, boredom, and despondency that must have been quite common when people couldn't read or were cooped up together in monasteries. But Dürer's application is far from simple. This figure is humanity at its most evolved, with wings to carry her upwards. And she sits in the attitude of Rodin's penseur and still holds in her hands the compasses, symbols of measurement by which science will conquer the world. Around her are all the emblems of constructive action. A saw, a plane, pincers, and those two prime elements in solid geometry, the sphere and the dodecahedron. And yet, all these aids to construction are abandoned, and she sits there brooding on the futility of human effort. Her obsessive stare reflects some deep psychic disturbance. The German mind that produced Dürer and the Reformation also produced psychoanalysis.
I began by mentioning the enemies of civilization. Well, here in Dürer's prophetic vision is one more way in which it can be destroyed from within. However, what made Dürer so important in his own age was that he combined an iron grip on the facts of appearance with an extremely fertile invention.
And as time went on, he became absolute master of all the techniques of his day, and in particular the science of perspective, which he used not simply as an intellectual game, but in order to increase the sense of reality. His woodcuts diffused a new way of looking at art, not as something magical or symbolic, but as something accurate and factual. His treatment of sacred subjects carried absolute conviction. I don't doubt that the many simple people who bought his woodcuts of the Life of the Virgin accepted them as a correct record. Dürer was immersed in the intellectual life of his time. In the same year that Erasmus completed his translation of St. Jerome's letters, Dürer did this delicate engraving of his hero at work. What an Erasmian room. Clear, sunny, orderly, with its reminder of death, but also with lots of cushions, which they don't give you in monasteries. And Dürer made an even more striking reference to Erasmus in the engraving of The Night with Death and the Devil. One of Erasmus's most widely read books was called The Handbook of the Christian Knight. And it was almost certainly in the artist's mind when he did this engraving, because he writes in a diary that refers to the engraving, "O Erasmus of Rotterdam, when wilt thou take thy stand? Hark, thou Knight of Christ, ride forth at the side of Christ our Lord. Protect the truth obtain the martyr's crown. Well, that wasn't at all Erasmus's line. And this grimly determined knight with his heavy Gothic armour forging ahead oblivious of the rather grotesque terrors that accost him is as far removed as possible from the agile intelligence and the nervous side glances of the great scholar.
For 15 years, Durer's cry to Erasmus was echoed by his contemporaries all over Europe, and it still appears in old-fashioned history books. Why didn't Erasmus intervene? Well, he wanted above all to avoid a violent split down the middle of the civilized world. He didn't think a revolution would make people happier. In fact, revolutions seldom do. In one of his letters, written soon after Durer had done his portrait, he says of the Protestants, "I have seen them return from hearing a sermon as if inspired by an evil spirit. The faces of all showed a curious wrath and ferocity." Although Erasmus seems to us so modern, he actually lived beyond his time. He was by nature a humanist of the early Renaissance. The heroic world of the 16th century was not his climate. To my mind, the extraordinary thing is what a huge following he had, and how close Erasmus, or at least the Erasmian point of view, came to success. It shows how many people, even in a time of crisis, yearn for tolerance and reason and simplicity of life. In fact, for civilization. But on the tide of fierce emotional and biological impulses, they are powerless. So, almost 20 years after the heroic spirit was made visible in the work of Michelangelo, it appears in Germany in the words and actions of Luther. Whatever else he may have been, Luther was a hero. And after all the doubts and hesitations of the humanists and the hovering flight of Erasmus, it's with a real sense of emotional relief that we hear Luther say, "Here I stand." We can see what this burning spirit was like because the local painter of Wittenberg, Lucas Cranach, was one of Luther's most trusted friends. And Cranach portrayed Luther in all his changing aspects. The tense, spiritually struggling monk, the great theologian with the brow of Michelangelo, the emancipated layman. Cranach was a witness of Luther's marriage and painted the portrait of his bride, an admirable and intelligent nun. Even in the disguise he wore when he escaped incognito to Wittenberg, no doubt he was extremely impressive, the leader for which the earnest German people is always waiting. Unfortunately for civilization, he not only settled their doubts and gave them the courage of their convictions, he also released their latent violence and hysteria. And beyond this was another northern characteristic that was fundamentally opposed to civilization, an earthy animal hostility to reason and decorum. One fancies that Nordic man took a long time to emerge from the primeval forest. Look at this old troll king who seems to have grown out of the earth. That's Luther's father, painted by Cranach.
He was a miner, with a miner's independence and strength of will. H.G. Wells once made a useful distinction between what he called communities of obedience and communities of will. He thought that the first, the communities of obedience, produced the stable societies like Egypt and Mesopotamia, the original homes of civilization, and that the second, the communities of will, produced the restless nomads of the north. He may be right. Anyway, the community of will that we call the Reformation was basically a popular movement. At the end of Erasmus's letter, in which he describes the surly Protestants coming out of church, he adds that none of them, except one old man, raised his hat. Erasmus was against forms and ceremonies and religion, but when he came to society, he felt differently. And so, strangely enough, did Luther. The great popular uprising known as the Peasants' Revolt filled him with horror, and he urged his princely patrons to put it down with the utmost ferocity. Luther didn't approve of destruction, even the destruction of images. but most of his followers were men who owed nothing to the past, to whom it meant no more than an intolerable servitude. And so Protestantism became destructive. And from the point of view of those who love what they see, it was a good deal of a disaster. Well, we all know about the destruction of images, what we nowadays call works of art. How commissioners went round not only to cathedrals like Ely, but even to the humblest parish churches and smashed everything of beauty that they contained, knocked the heads off statues, smashed up the carved font covers, broke the reredos, broke anything within reach. It didn't pay them to stay too long on a single job. You can see the results here in the Lady Chapel at Ely. All the painted glass smashed, and unfortunately, the beautiful series of carvings of the life of the Virgin was within reach. And they've knocked off every head, made a marvellous job of it. There wasn't much religion about it. It was an instinct to destroy anything comely, anything that reflected a state of mind that ignorant people couldn't share. The very existence of these incomprehensible values enraged them. The visible aspect of civilization took a hard knock from Protestantism, or if you prefer it, from H.G. Wells's Community of Will. And in some ways, it never recovered. For example, one can't point to a single piece of specifically Protestant architecture or sculpture, which shows how much these expressions of civilization depended on the Catholic Church. But it had to happen. If Western civilization was not to wither or petrify, like the civilization of ancient Egypt, it had to draw life from a larger area than that which had nourished the intellectual and artistic triumphs of the Renaissance. And ultimately, a new civilization emerged. But it was a civilization not of the image, but of the word. Luther gave his countrymen words. Erasmus had written solely in Latin. Luther translated the Bible into German, noble German too, as far as I can judge, and so gave people not only a chance to read Holy Writ for themselves, but the tools of thought. And the medium of printing was there to make it accessible. The translations of the Bible by Calvin into French, by Tyndale and Coverdale into English, were crucial in the development of the Western mind. And if I hesitate to say to the development of civilization, it's because they were also a stage in the growth of nationalism. And as I've said, and shall go on saying this series, nearly all the steps upward of civilization have been in periods of internationalism. Well, whatever the long-term effects of Protestantism, the immediate results were very bad. Not only bad for art, but bad for life. The North was full of bully boys. They appear frequently in 16th century German art, very pleased with themselves, apparently much admired. They rampaged about the country and took any excuse to beat people up. All the elements of destruction were let loose. 30 years earlier, Dürer had done a series of wood engravings illustrating the apocalypse. You can say that they express the Gothic side of his nature, or you can regard them as prophetic, because they show with terrifyingly effective precision the horrors that were to descend on Western Europe, both sides proclaiming themselves as the instruments of God's wrath. Fire rains down from heaven on kings, popes, monks, and poor families. And those who escape the fire fall victim to the avenging sword. It's a terrible thought that so-called wars of religion, religion of course being used as a pretext for political ambitions, but still providing a sort of emotional dynamo, that wars of religion went on for 120 years and were accompanied by such revolting episodes as the massacre of St. Bartholomew. What could an intelligent, human, open-minded man do in mid-16th century Europe? Keep quiet, work in solitude, outwardly conform, inwardly remain free. The wars of religion evoked a figure new to European civilization, although familiar in the great ages of China, the intellectual recluse. Petrarch and Erasmus had used their brains at the highest level of politics. They had been the advisors of princes. Their successor,
the greatest humanist of the mid-16th century, retreats into his tower. It was a real tower, not the ivory tower of cliché language. This man who retreated into his tower was Michel de Montaigne. He was a fairly conscientious mayor of Bordeaux, but he refused to go any nearer to the center of power. He preferred his tower, where through his window, in his own words, he enjoyed a far-extending, rich and unresisted prospect. There is my seat, there is my throne. He was born in southern France in 1533. His mother was a Jewish Protestant, his father a Catholic. He had no illusions about the effect of the religious convictions released by the Reformation. He said, in trying to make themselves angels, men transformed themselves into beasts. But Montaigne was not only detached from the two religious factions, he was slightly skeptical about the Christian religion altogether. He said, I would willingly carry a candle in one hand for St. Michael and in the other for his dragon. Actually, he was thinking of a picture of his patron saint that hung in this room. His essays are as crammed with quotations as are the tracts of the warring priests. But instead of being texts from the Bible, they are quotations from the authors of Greece and Rome, whose works he seems to have known almost by heart. He had his favorite quotations written on the beams of his study. And the one above my head says, Homo sum humani a me nihil alienum puto. I am a man, and think that nothing human is foreign to me. He used these texts, as the Reformers had used the Bible, to find out the truth. But it was a concept of truth very different from that which serious men had sought in Collett's sermons or Erasmus's New Testament. It involved always looking at the other side of every question, however shocking, by conventional standards, that other side might be. Burning a candle, both to St. Michael and his dragon. And it was a truth that depended on the testimony of the only person he could examine without shame or scruple, himself. In the past, self-examination had been painful and penitential. To Montaigne, it was a pleasure. But as he says, no pleasure hath savour unless I can communicate it. And in order to do so, he invented the essay, which was to remain the accepted form of humanist communication for three centuries. These self-searchings really marked the end of the heroic spirit. As Montaigne says, sit we upon the highest throne in the world, yet sit we only upon our own tails. The strange thing is that people on high thrones didn't resent Montaigne. On the contrary, they sought his company. Had he lived, his friend Henry IV might have forced him to become Chancellor of France. But he preferred to remain here, in his tower. Such was the egocentric isolation that the wars of religion forced on the most civilized man in late 16th century Europe. But there was one country in which, after 1570, men could live without fear of civil war or sudden revenge, unless they happened to be Jesuit priests, England. England, which was almost untouched by the visible signs of the Renaissance, which had little painting and no sculpture, but had developed a fantastic architecture of its own. It's debatable how far Elizabethan England can be called civilized. Certainly, it doesn't provide a reproducible pattern of civilization, as does, for example, 18th century France. It was brutal, unscrupulous, and disorderly. But if, as I've suggested, the first requisites of civilization are intellectual energy, freedom of mind, a sense of beauty, and a craving for immortality, then the age of Spenser and Marlowe, of Dowland and Bird, was a kind of civilization. This is the background of Shakespeare. Well, of course, we can't compress Shakespeare into the scale of the program, but I can't altogether omit him because one of the first ways in which I would justify civilization is that it can produce a genius on this scale. In his freedom of mind, in his power of self-identification, in his complete absence of any dogma, Shakespeare sums up and illuminates the piece of history that I've just described. His mature plays are, amongst other things, the poetical fulfillment of Montaigne's intellectual honesty. In fact, we know that the first edition, English edition, of Montaigne made a deep impression on Shakespeare. But Shakespeare's scepticism was more complete and more uncomfortable. Instead of Montaigne's detachment, there's a spirit of passionate engagement. And instead of the essay, there's the urgent communication of the stage.
What? Not mad? A man may see how this world goes without eyes. Look with thine ears. Thou rascal beadle, hold thy bloody hand. Why dost thou lash that whore? Strip thine own back. Thou hotly lust'st to use her in that kind for which thou whipp'st her. The usurer hangs the cozener. Through tattered clothes small vices do appear. Robes and furred gowns hide all. Plate sin with gold, and the strong lance of justice hurtless breaks. Arm it in rags, a pygmy's straw does pierce it. None does offend. None, I say. None.
Pure Montaigne, with a difference. You know, this must be the first time, and may well be the last time, that a supremely great poet has been without religion.
Tomorrow, and tomorrow, and tomorrow, creeps in this petty pace from day to day to the last syllable of recorded time. And all our yesterdays have lighted fools the way to dusty death. Out, out, brief candle. Life's but a walking shadow. A poor player that struts and frets his hour upon the stage and then is heard no more. It is a tale told by an idiot, full of sound and fury, signifying nothing.
How unthinkable before the breakup of Christendom, the tragic split that followed the Reformation. And yet, I feel that the human mind has gained a new strength by outstaring this emptiness.
How long will a man lie in the earth ere he rot?
In faith, if he be not rotten before he die, as we have many pocky courses nowadays as will scarce hold the lying in. Oh, it lasts you 8 year or 9 year. A tanner will last you 9 year.
Why he more than another?
Why, sir, his hide is so tanned with his trade as will keep out water a great while. And your water is a sore decayer of your horse and dead body. Here is a skull that hath lain you in the earth 23 year.
Whose was it?
A whoreson mad fellow it was. Whose do you think it was?
Nay, I know not.
Pestilence on him for a mad rogue. Poured a flagon of Rhenish on my head once. This same skull, sir. Yorick's skull. The king's jester.
This?
Ain't that?
Let me see.
Alas, poor Yorick. I knew him, Horatio. A fellow of infinite jest, of most excellent fancy. He hath borne me on his back 1,000 times. And now, how abhorred in my imagination it is. My gorge rises at it. Here hung those lips that I have kissed, I know not how oft. Where be your jibes now? Your gambols? Your songs? your flashes of merriment that were wont to set the table on a roar. Not one now to mock your own grinning, but quite chapfallen. Now, get thee to my lady's chamber, and tell her, let her paint an inch thick. To this favor, she must come. Make her laugh at that. I pray thee, Horatio, tell me one thing.
What's that, my lord?
Dost thou think Alexander looked to this fashion of the earth?
In so.
And smelt so.
In so, my lord.
To what base uses we may return, Horatio. Why may not imagination trace the noble dust of Alexander till he find it stopping a bunghole?
But to consider too curiously to consider so.
Oh, faith, not a jot. But to follow him thither with modesty enough and likelihood to lead it. As thus, Alexander died. Alexander was buried. Alexander returneth to dust. The dust is earth. Of earth we make loam. And why, of that loam, whereto he was converted, might they not stop a beer barrel? Imperious Caesar, dead and turned to clay, might stop a hole to keep the wind away. Oh, that that earth which held the world in awe might patch a wall to expel the winter's floor.
If Western civilization was not to wither or petrify, like the civilization of ancient Egypt, it had to draw life from a larger area than that which had nourished the intellectual and artistic triumphs of the Renaissance. And, ultimately, a new civilization emerged. But it was a civilization not of the image, but of the word. Luther gave his countrymen words. Erasmus had written solely in Latin. Luther translated the Bible into German, noble German too, as far as I can judge, and so gave people not only a chance to read Holy Writ for themselves, but the tools of thought. And the medium of printing was there to make it accessible. The translations of the Bible by Calvin into French, by Tyndale and Coverdale into English, were crucial in the development of the Western mind. And if I hesitate to say to the development of civilization, it's because they were also a stage in the growth of nationalism. And as I've said, and shall go on saying this series, nearly all the steps upward in civilization have been in periods of apparently much admired. They rampaged about the country and took any excuse to beat people up. All the elements of destruction were let loose. 30 years earlier, Dürer had done a series of wood engravings illustrating the apocalypse. You can say that they express the Gothic side of his nature, or you can regard them as prophetic, because they show with terrifyingly effective precision the horrors that were to descend on Western Europe, both sides proclaiming themselves as the instruments of God's wrath. fire rains down from heaven on kings, popes, monks, and poor families. And those who escape the fire fall victim to the avenging sword. It's a terrible thought that so-called wars of religion, religion of course being used as a pretext for political ambitions, but still providing a sort of emotional dynamo, that
which following he had, and how close Erasmus, or at least the Erasmian point of view, came to success. It shows how many people, even in a time of crisis, yearn for tolerance and reason and simplicity of life, in fact, for civilization. But on the tide of fierce emotional and biological impulses, they are powerless. So, almost 20 years after the heroic spirit was made visible in the work of Michelangelo, it appears in Germany in the words and actions of Luther. Whatever else he may have been, Luther was a hero. And after all the doubts and hesitations of the humanists and the hovering flight of Erasmus, it's with a real sense of emotional relief that we hear Luther say, "Here I stand." But if Dürer didn't try to peer so deeply into the inner life of nature, nor feel, as Leonardo did, its appalling independence of mankind, he was deeply engaged by the mystery of the human psyche. His obsession with his own personality was part of a passionate interest in psychology in general, and this led him to produce one of the great prophetic documents of Western man, the engraving he entitled Melancholia I. In the Middle Ages, melancholia had meant a simple combination of sloth, boredom, and despondency that must have been quite common when people couldn't read or were cooped up together in monasteries. But Dürer's application is far from simple. This figure is humanity at its most evolved, with wings to carry her upwards. And she sits in the attitude of Rodin's penseur and still holds in her hands the compasses, symbols of measurement by which science will conquer the world. Around her are all the emblems of constructive action. A saw, a plane, pincers, and those two prime elements in solid geometry, the sphere and the dodecahedron. And yet, all these aids to construction are abandoned, and she sits there brooding on the futility of human effort. Her obsessive stare reflects some deep psychic disturbance. The German mind that produced Dürer and the Reformation also produced psychoanalysis. I began by mentioning the enemies of civilization. Well, here in Dürer's prophetic vision is one more way in which it can be destroyed from within. However, what made Dürer so important in his own age was that he combined an iron grip on the facts of appearance with an extremely fertile invention. And as time went on, he became absolute master of all the techniques of his day, and in particular, the science of perspective, which he used not simply as an intellectual game, but in order to increase the sense of reality. His woodcuts diffused a new way of looking at art, not as something magical or symbolic, but as something accurate and factual. His treatment of sacred subjects carried absolute conviction. I don't doubt that the many simple people who bought his woodcuts of the life of the Virgin accepted them as a correct record.